We saw that all the experiences are vibrations, patterns of change. In what are these vibrations happening? And we saw that they are non-substantial. The infinite potential appears in form of a binary vibration, and the combinations of these waves produce the experience. Where are these vibrations happening? It is the whole existence itself that is vibrating in many, many patterns. At the same time, at the same place. The nature of the existence is non-local and non-temporal. So nothing really changes. But there is an illusion that there is something. It looks like that the changes are happening around us. It looks like that I am immersed in these changes, in these patterns. And it also looks like that it is not really vibration. It is not really changing. My house is the same house since many years. The trees around my house, they do change, but they are the same trees. People, they seem to change in looks and behavior, but they are the same people. There is a stability in the flow of changes. We are going to talk about this apparent stability. But right now, a bigger question is that why do these changes stick? Why are they not totally random? Because if they are vibrations, then they should be completely random. The patterns, even if they form, they should simply disperse in split second. There is nothing that keeps them glued together. But we also saw that there are random patterns everywhere, but they are kind of not registered by the senses. The randomness is filtered out by the senses, or you can say only the meaningful patterns are filtered through the senses. Senses do not allow everything. What they allow is something that sticks, something that is meaningful, something when it is compared with other patterns in the memory produces a meaning. The rest are ignored, and it is literally so that we do not really see things which do not make sense. We see that which the eyes are trained to see. We hear only that which our minds are trained to hear. The advantage of the senses and limitations is that they provide a stable experience, but the disadvantage is that the experience gets locked in this stability. The senses construct a fort for themselves, and then the experiences are limited and trapped in that fort. The experiences stick because there is a special kind of vibration. There is a special pattern, and the quality of this pattern is that it takes on the form of other patterns. In this sea of vibrations, some patterns, they come in contact with this special pattern and transform it so that it starts resembling the other pattern. This is a very, very well-known phenomena. It can be called induction or can be called resonance. When you play a tune in a room in which some tuning forks are placed, you will find that the tuning fork that vibrates is the one that is in tune with what is being played. The vibrations are induced through resonance, through mutual reinforcement of vibrations. So it looks like that the tuning fork has copied the incoming vibrations, the vibrations in the air. And it looks like that the tuning fork now remembers its own frequency. You can take another simple example that when you pour water on a bed of dry clay, you will find that initially the water goes everywhere in random directions. But if you keep on pouring water at same place, you will find that soon channels are formed in the clay. And the next time you pour water there, now the water goes in those channels instead of going somewhere else. It looks like the water remembers where to go. But it is only that the repetitions of flow have etched a pattern on the clay. And now there is no other way for the water to flow. It goes there because of necessity. The pattern that is formed on the clay can be called a memory. When this memory is excited, which means the water is poured into it, we get the same pattern again and again and again. Similar to the example of the tuning fork, when it is struck, it produces the same tone as if it remembers to produce it. But actually, its form allows it to produce only one tone again and again and again. So a pattern that stores impressions from other patterns is a special vibration that is called memory. It takes on a form of incoming pattern. If a change happens frequently in one way, then it induces the same change in its surroundings, and the impression that is formed on the surrounding is a memory of the change that impinged on it, that impressed on it. Just like when we press our hand on the wet sand, we get an impression of the hand. It is a memory of the hand. The pattern that is the hand is now transferred to the sand, which resembles a little bit like the hand. It is a mold, and if you pour metal into it or something like that, wax, it takes on a shape of the hand. It replays that which formed the memory. So we saw in the previous episodes that all experiences are experiences of the memory. All the changes or vibrations, they are impinging on the memory and they are coming via the senses. And these impressions are being experienced. Because without memory, without this special process of induction or resonance or memorization, impression, the incoming vibrations, they simply pass through it. Nothing is experienced if there is no memory. You can also do this thought experiment by successively cutting down the duration of the memory. 1 year, 1 month, 1 day, 1 hour, then 1 minute, and then 1 second, then 1 millisecond, and a microsecond. And you will find that your experience is reducing. It is very strange. Although everything is as it should be, the smaller memories, they produce very rudimentary experience. And when the memory is zero, we are reduced to a mechanical device, which is not experiencing anything. The eyes just become cameras that take in the pictures, but there is nobody looking at them. There is no experience of the picture. The memory stores the picture. And since memory is a pattern in the existence, it is existence itself which has taken on this impression. There is a necessity that it will be in contact with it itself, because it is itself, and that produces an experience, that produces a consciousness of this pattern. Otherwise, there is no way to become conscious. Without memory, nothing appears, no consciousness appears, no experiencer is seen. This is very strange, amazing, mind-blowing, as well as beautiful. So this answers many questions like, why do we need senses, why do we need vibrations, and why do we need a memory or a mind to experience anything at all? And when these things are destroyed, they are taken away, nothing remains. Or we seem to think that nothing remains. It is because of the necessity. It is because if this did not happen, no experience will be produced, no experiencer will arise. And we will never know that there is experiencer, and we'll never know that it is possible to experience anything. Memory makes it possible. This is just another pattern of vibrations that has taken on a form of any patterns that impressed on itself. These patterns, they keep on piling in the memory, and they self-organize to form structures. Not all of them form structures that are meaningful, but some are very well organized. That is called information. As we saw in the episode on the information, this kind of structure is called a low entropy structure. It has more order in it. Entropy is a measure of order in information theory. So these low entropy structures enable a meaningful experience. Although memory itself enables experience, but they are not meaningful. It is like a baby staring at the world around it. It experiences it. But you cannot say that the baby is understanding what he is experiencing. He is trying to grasp. His mind is still organizing. His memory is still being built up by formation of connections between different experiences. If he sees a colorful shape and it is accompanied by a sound, a funny sound, the baby forms relations between two experiences. And now next time it repeats, the memory recall happens and the baby smiles. A reward is produced in the mind because there is a recognition. This is the entrainment of the memory. So it is just one of the process. We are going to go into the details of processes in the memory. But for now, this should give you an idea about the relation between experiences and memory, meaning and information. That also explains why I see the same tree every day, why my house did not vaporize into random patterns instantly. Because these patterns are etched in a memory. Since they are vibrations, since they are change, they are changing. But the change is slow enough so that they remain meaningful for some time. This gives us an illusion of stability. That look, everything is just as it is. The things I saw yesterday, they are here. The things as I recall from 10 years ago, they are still here. There is this same mountain. There is this same sky, same sun, same moon, same earth, same people. What we ignore is that there are tiny changes that have happened. Some things, they look stable because the changes in them are so tiny that the memory returns with a comparison result that shows no difference at all. It is below our perception, below that which the senses can even detect. And that gives us an illusion of stability. That is very, very important for survival of this organism. And now you know why. Only this kind of process will enable survival or any organism or any life at all. And that is why this is our experience. It is all necessity. If the patterns did not arrange like this, if they did not give us an impression of stability, no life is possible. So now you can appreciate the importance of the memory. Yes, the vibrations are important, but too much randomness, too much freedom there. Limiting the freedom produces meaning, produces information, produces low entropy. Otherwise, it's all chaos. Organization of this chaos, although it limits it, produces meaning, produces stability. It is possible only because there is a possibility that one pattern will leave an impression on another pattern. The second pattern is now defined as the memory. All experiences are experiences of memories. Not only that which we are experiencing presently through the senses is a memory, they are being stored in our personal memories. The memory that is outside you is getting transmitted to the memory that is inside you via the gates of senses. That which is outside is a memory, but it cannot be perceived as it is. The memory is not physical, it is not mental, and only the disturbances that are being received from those patterns, they are being received and they are then organized again in a personal memory. That is what is being perceived. So these memory patterns, they are semi-permanent. They are not permanent. There is only a little bit of illusion of stability. But because they are resonating and are like standing vibrations, standing waves, they self-reinforce themselves again and again and again. They provide a little bit of permanency. So I'm going to call this kind of memory a semi-permanent vibration. It is not physical and it is not mental. And sometimes I use this prefix in front of the memory just to remind us that we should not take these patterns as something of substance or something in the mind. It is much more fundamental. So just to remind us, I call it the NPNM memory. The memory that produces the physical and mental experiences. It is very fundamental. And it is just a vibration. It is a special one that has qualities to retain a pattern there. Via self-reinforcement or resonance in a fashion of a standing wave. There are some limitations to this memory, where it cannot easily let go of that pattern. For example, we saw in the example of the wet clay, there is a now limitation there which does not allow the water to flow in any other way. Yes, but the limitation is also not permanent. You can stomp on the clay and then it is possible to destroy that memory, to erase it, the memory, and then new patterns are formed. Similarly, the tuning fork is bound to produce only one tone. There is a limitation there. But yes, you can cut it off and then it can produce another tone whenever it is hit. So frankly, I don't know what causes a limitation in the NPNM memory. What is it that is keeping it from dispersing into the randomness? But it seems that once a memory is formed, it is forever. The memory is just a possibility, and that possibility is forever. There is nothing which can destroy the possibilities. Yes, its experience comes and goes. That does not remain. But the possibility remains. And since the possibility is in the existence, and the existence or this emptiness is timeless, these possibilities are eternal. The memories are timeless. The memories are eternal. Memories are forever. So something very beautiful here to consider, that once something appears in memory, it stays there forever. The change is simply comparison of two memories, two patterns, which means that the old one is there and the new one is also there at the same time, and the illusion of the change happens because of the comparison of these two patterns. So change is not fundamental in the sense that it is happening in the existence. Memory is fundamental. And even more fundamental than memory is the potential which keeps the memory alive. You can always get back to the potential, and the pattern is there. It is never destroyed, because I don't know any ways to destroy a potential. Yes, the experience can be destroyed because now it can be seen as changed. A different kind of comparison has happened, but the memory remains. In other words, change does not imply that the memory has been destroyed. It has a very strange implications. You planted the tree outside your house 10 years ago and it was a tiny sapling. Now it is a giant tree. What happened to the sapling? You will say that it changed into the tree. But in the light of whatever I said just now, the sapling is still there. It is in a memory. It is a possibility. It is a potential that is still there in a timeless manner. Yes, our cognition has moved forward because of the comparative processes in the memory. But somewhere beyond physical and mental realms, there is a sapling, and there are all the forms that it took to grow into the big tree. They are all saved. They are all stored. Just like we store our precious memories. Existence stores everything. Existence has infinite memory. Yes, there is a possibility that it will be erased from our personal memories, which are a shadow of what is outside. And you may not remember when did you plant this tree and what, how did it look like. Probably that cannot be recalled now. But it simply means that your recall is impaired. Probably that impression is still there somewhere in your mind. And even if that impression is gone, the existence has stored all the stages of that tree as it was growing, as it was changing. And it has done that for everything, even the tiniest particle in this existence. It has done that for all the universes, all people, all creatures. They are eternally impressed on the memory of the existence. Now imagine the possibilities here. It should be possible to rewind to these memories and you can experience them again. And it is possible to go forward in the memories and you can experience the future. This model allows for such kind of magical experiences. And because these are just patterns, you can create any pattern in the memory. And so we can have any experience. Anything can appear, anything can disappear. The creative potential of this existence is infinite also. Yes, but I cannot do that. Yes, there is a problem here because existence is doing that. If you think that I am this pattern, this human body, then obviously it cannot do much. It itself is a pattern. But if you elevate yourself to the rank of existence, I am everything, then it is you who are doing everything. Or you can say, you are creating everything, you are destroying everything, you are changing everything, and all memories are your memories. The whole of the existence is me. And probably because I have already done everything billions of times, I don't need to do anything more, because there is a possibility to do everything, and now there is a possibility to do everything a billion times also. And then repeat these things once again a billion times. Because infinity is my nature. It is happening right now also because I am timeless as existence. Yes, if there is still ignorance remaining which says that I am this tiny pattern which comes and goes, a semi-permanent shadow in the memory of the existence, then the possibilities are almost zero. It arises and it falls, just like anything else in the memory. The good news is it's not you. And if you're still wondering how is possible that I am the existence, that means you need to listen to the past episodes again. So in coming episodes, we are going to dig deeper in the memory. Let us find out all the secrets of the memory.